Welcome, welcome back. Best audience ever. Mission accepted. Yes, one more person decided to take the mission. And the interesting thing is she has been taking this mission on and off a lot longer than our show's been on air in, like, I don't know, maybe 25 years. Anyways, you guys know that you're the best audience because you just know it, because you send me messages and I send you messages back and I tell you that you rock. But you know what? For today's show, you are the most beautiful audience. Inside and out. What's she going to talk about today, they say? What's she going to talk about today? I want you to meet the Jessica Tatlow. She is the on and off entrepreneurial queen. We were just talking earlier about what does it take to take the mission? You guys know that's what this whole show is about. If you are inspired or thinking to be inspired about doing your own thing, whatever that looks like, then you guys come here and you get fueled up, you laugh a little bit, but you know that you've got a tribe here. You know, you've got people that are doing the same thing, back against the wall sometimes, trying to make things work, trying to figure it out. So you have a community, and I know because I love you too. Anyways, Jessica has been an entrepreneur, like I said, on and off for 25 years. And for her, it's really important from a mental health standpoint that you really dig into what you do. You really find that joy place. And she's going to tell you where to go find her on TikTok because she rocks it out and talks about that quite a bit. And she's been following her path. And I think she will probably be one of the first to admit, and so are we, that it's not always an uphill. You know, it's not always an uphill. Sometimes it coasts, sometimes it dips. But Jessica, thank you so much for being such a transparent entrepreneur. That's what I really, when I have a conversation with you, I'm like, you are super real and transparent and you talk about the real deal. So welcome to Mission Accepted.
Thank you. I'm really excited to be here. I'm a little nervous, not going to lie, but I'm very excited.
Yeah. See, that's what I told you. Transparent. She's just a transparent entrepreneur.
I'm literally sitting on my bed because I was like, I could go up and sit in my desk. And I'm like, no. I'm just going to sit back on some pillows on my bed because that's who I am. I like to be comfortable. So
yeah, absolutely. Had to be there. So look, I want everyone to know because everyone's been hearing about this stand up, speak up, show up, big international women's event that we're doing, largest and boldest International Women's Day in terms of speakership and authorship. And you are going to be rocking the stage this year, and you are also going to be in the book. Super excited and super honored to have you there.
Thank you.
So tell us a little bit about what entrepreneurship means to you. When you say, like, you know, follow your path, a lot of times we hear that, but we don't really know that. So you, like you said, you've been on and off with your going in different directions per se, but the one direction you stay true to is what was true to you at that time. So maybe give us a little bit of your insight on that.
So, yeah. So, I mean, I could go way back, but I'm just going to go a little back here. So I loved, Deb, that you had mentioned at the last meeting that we had about your mom and when you were younger and how she showed you what an entrepreneur is and the things that she did, the little home businesses, those parties. That really resonated with me because that was totally my mom. And she taught me from a really young age to work hard. So did my dad. My dad was a blue-collared worker and has retired as such. And they've always taught me to work really hard. I also learned what it was like to make money in a pinch when you need to make money. And so in order to do that, you have to really think outside the box really, really quickly. But not just that, you have to sit there and evaluate everything around you. So you have to ask yourself questions like, why am I doing this? What am I willing to do? Or what are my abilities in order to make money? And some people overthink that sometimes, I think anyways, that we overthink that and we start to freak out and then we start to doubt ourselves and we go, oh, well, we can't, or I can't do this, or whatever the case may be. I mean, my mom did bake sales and I participated in those bake sales. We didn't have a lot of money growing up. We were not well off at all whatsoever. In fact, there were times that I remember my parents having quiet discussions, and myself and my sister were the older ones, we're 18 months apart. Of four kids, and my younger brothers never really heard a lot of these conversations, but we were older, we understood, and we often heard them talking about even not even being able to afford milk. And that was because we lived in Ontario at the time and milk was delivered to our home. And so the milkman came and he came to collect the check. Sometimes my mom just didn't even have it. And so he was a very nice guy. He'd leave the milk anyways, yada, yada, yada. And then later she'd have to pay, or my dad would pay it or whatever. And so early on, my mom taught us, in order to make money quick or in a pinch, this is one way of doing it. But in order to become good at something, yes, in education is important, going to school and everything, but how crucial is it in order to even learn a trade or learn how to really put yourself out there, even when you're feeling like you maybe don't think that you can do this. So I have learned that some of the best parts of entrepreneurship are specifically just jumping into it, just attacking it full force. And it's kind of like gambling in a sense, and that brings people's anxieties through the roof, but it always excites me and it's very exhilarating. It's kind of like taking that plunge. And so growing up, that's how I was. I've always done that. I've always done the plunge or lived my life with gumption and just like attacked something. Now, have I always like stuck with it? Not necessarily. Have I succeeded in things? I used to be like, oh, I'm a failure. I didn't succeed in this. I'm not very successful. Or this didn't work out after a couple of years. I give it my all. I don't just try it and then be like, nah. I give it my all. Like I said, I self-evaluate everything. Can I do this? What am I capable of? Yada, yada, yada. And I think that's important. Those are very important aspects or important things to question ourselves about and ask ourselves about. But most importantly, I think it's, you have to be in the right headspace. You have to be in the right frame of mind. But more importantly, you have to know who you are internally. And I think sometimes even when we measure success, we look at very successful people, celebrities, million-dollar earners, doctors, whatever. We look at them and they go, excuse me, I got the hiccups trying to come up. I'm trying to force them down. We think of, they're very successful. They have it all together. And I don't have it all together, so I can't do that. And that's not the case. I believe that in order to build something, whether it's you're going to go out and get a 9-to-5 job or whatever, a night shift somewhere or whatever, or if you're going to work for yourself, regardless of which, you have to learn discipline and you have to learn to believe in yourself in order to do well in that job. And so I don't think that there's specifically just one part. There's just so many different aspects in entrepreneurship and that I specifically enjoy. And I did talk about like my mom, and that in turn has helped me with different makeup businesses and different skincare companies, different hair care companies. I'm a trained hairstylist of 24 years. I retired about, it's been almost 5 years ago. And at that time, I opened a little flower shop and I loved it. And it was kind of like an everything shop. We had a flower shop on the one side. We had a little cafe on the other side that we served like coffees, teas, hot chocolates, all those kind of things, homemade ice cream sandwiches. We did meals for a short, brief period of time. And then on the other side where the flowers were, we had a whole fabric section and arts and crafts and party supplies, and then a women's boutique. So about just under 4,000 square feet of a lot of things, but I live in a small town. And so it was necessary to have a variety shop like that. It was very organized in sections, but it went really, really well. Right out the gates, we were like, wow, this is going amazing. We were blowing through thousands a month. It was great. I was like, this is amazing. This is what the community needs. We're just going to soar with this. And funny enough, we bought this little shop that we saw this vision for. So it was completely different before we bought it. We bought it 9 months before COVID. And so, I mean, the Canadian government offered lots of help with small businesses. Unfortunately, we couldn't collect anything. We weren't in business the year before. So for tax purposes, that kind of sucked. Mm-hmm. So you look at that and you go, huh. And I used to be an all or nothing person. I'm like, I'm going to give it my all. I don't care. But at that point, I was like, oh, boy. You know, and is that where we just give up? Is that where we just go, hands up, I'm done? And at the same time, I was like, no, it's not in me to do that. So we fought through it. We made it through COVID, which was shocking enough. In fact, we had some times during COVID, we bought out another flower shop. She was closing down, having hardships in a neighboring town. We bought out a little clothing company in another neighboring town. We bought out, or we actually took on an entire other community because their flower shop flooded out so bad that they had to close down for about 4 months, 5 months. So we had some great business and great success. in increments. COVID was a whole nother story. We all know that. Mm-hmm. It was like a roller coaster for so many businesses. And yeah. Same. I love roller coasters, but that ride sucked really bad. So I did not enjoy that at all.
Yeah, we want a refund on our ticket, please.
Right? But it was that experience that when we were going through times that were really hard, like things that all of a sudden going from thousands and thousands to barely even $1,000 in a month and being like, how the heck are we going to pay our bills? Mm-hmm. Oh my gosh, this is so scary. Because we had times like that too. It was a crazy roller coaster that we did not enjoy. And you really have to dig deep. And at that time, I was going through things in my life that I never really thought was that big of a deal. I was raised by a mother who taught me to fight and to work and to love myself and to always be your best self and do what you can and, you know, how to adapt, but also how to find the good in everything. And so I started to not see the good in everything. And it was starting to make me feel just angry at the world and angry at everything and angry at my life and my family and myself and everything around. Because you just, it goes into like a snowball effect, right?
Right.
And I felt like it was a really dumb move. We should have never bought the store. But then I had to shake it off and be like, no. This can't be this reason. There's got to be more to this. And digging deeper and deeper into myself, I realized why for years I had to have different businesses that either, I don't know. It's hard to say failed, because when you don't fail at something, but you feel like you've done really well, but you sell it off, or you decide to close it down, or you decide to move forward on something else. I personally don't think that's a failure. Maybe I'm wrong.
No, that's a failure. Let's Some cut people, in there for a minute. Let's cut right? in there for a minute. Because you've hit the nail on the head. I want to talk, but you just nailed it. I want to talk about this a little bit, because entrepreneurs can be, one, really hard on themselves, for sure. Two, many times we are dedicated, loyal, and we're in with two feet, because that's what makes entrepreneurship. And sometimes it's really hard when there's circumstances outside of yourself, like, there's a pandemic. So sometimes there's things outside of ourselves that force us into a different state of reevaluation and have to make different decisions and we talk about that as an entrepreneur. It's like when it didn't go to where you thought it was going to go, but in 2 years or 3 years or 4 years down the road, something else and took you in a different direction and totally it felt like the right thing, but this thing never really completed to the visualization that we had in the beginning. And somehow we don't think it's successful, but this is where I said this the other day to somebody. It's like, you know how there's like, till death do us part, death do us part. And sometimes we think to now look at, you guys don't send me emails about marriage. I'm not talking about marriage and all that stuff, but till death do us part sometimes means when something no longer is alive, when something no longer is holding true. And so we, you know, kind of go crazy with ourselves on, I didn't take it all away. I didn't, you know, own 12 studios. I owned one studio. I didn't let, you know, you didn't take it all away. Because you're a visual person who sees the 20-year goal plan, but something in your heart tells you to go over here. So it did, and it was successful. And it could have been the stepping stone that takes you to this, to take you to this. I mean, at the end of the game, end of the game, if you look back and you had one entrepreneur career and one sector and one da 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 da, or you had 25, like what makes someone decide what's successful? What makes someone decide what wasn't a failure? What makes someone, and the word failure is just ridiculous, because it's not a failure if you recognize, if you're smart enough to recognize the lifespan of the vision. And sometimes, you know, I always say, like, paint the picture, do the deal, jump in with two feet. And, you know, and sometimes you have a plan, and sometimes the universe has another plan, and sometimes they just don't, you know, they're not aligned, right? So I just wanted to hit that a nail on the head there a little bit, because it's a tough one for entrepreneurs. So
it
tough.
It sure is. And people are so hard on themselves. And the reason why I said it the way I did, because I was like, well, you guys can call it failure, like, is because I would have 5 years ago been like, and I totally failed at that. And COVID was stupid and this was crappy and yada, yada, yada. But I've learned so much, especially within this last year and a half, more so than I've ever learned in my entire life, in the entire 20 some odd years, 25 almost years that I've been going on and off on my own. I don't even know how to do this without saying it out loud and blunt. Mental health is so important. I've already shared with you that I had an incredible mom, incredible dad. They taught me incredible work ethic. They taught us all about taking care of ourselves, mentally, emotionally, spiritually. They had expectations. We strived to set goals. I love goal setting. Oh, I love goal setting. And so that for myself was something that I always like, oh yeah, no, I was raised great. And, you know, but there was something within myself that I didn't really realize was so broken. And this becomes very vulnerable, where you're very broken, but you take that, and instead of beating yourself down and instead of finding all your faults, you start to really evaluate things and dig deep in order to feel your power. I think it's so important as an entrepreneur that you want to be successful, but what is your level of success? How do you measure that? And what does the successfulness mean? What does successfulness mean to you? If it's just dollar bills, well, there's definitely a world out there for that. But if it's happiness and dollar bills, I mean, isn't that the most perfect dream?
That's
the perfect dream. Yeah. But if it's just happiness and then stepping stones, like you were just saying, Deb, stepping stones in order to build your success or to build something greater for you to achieve or to even recognize, that to me is very successful.
I think, you know, let's talk about, there's been a lot of redefining the word success. I was saying something the other day, I'm like, oh my gosh, I don't know if I'm sick of hearing about success, saying the word success, describing the word success, but there has been an evolution of that picture. You know, we did have an idea, you know, people that were successful were on TV. People that were successful were in these categories of careers. These, I mean, that's kind of where we come from, where there's people that do very different things, jobs we never thought even existed, you know, like never even thought existed. But I think it's come full circle, very much full circle, that happiness and money don't equate, that happiness and titles don't equate, but they can. It's just that they don't have to be the end game, like the financial piece. And I believe that we are starting to, as the world gets more complicated in a way, a lot more technology in a way, a lot more opportunities, you know, in a way, like, you know, we may look back at some point, Jessica, and go, wow, I only had to choose between four careers. You know, look at what the, look what the generation now, they can really aptitude to pretty well anything. And that probably has its own ball of wax, has probably has its own level of stress.
Well, there's but so I many believe, careers. Oh, sorry, go ahead.
No, I was just gonna say, I really believe we're defining the word success. Yes. And I think the longer you've been an entrepreneur, you also do some evaluation around that as well.
And it's funny because I look at my own children and I'm like, because we have six kids, and I look at them and I know there's been comments, even my husband and I have talked about it, you know, where people are like, oh, kids these days just don't know what hard work is. And I'm like, I think it's just a whole different struggle. I think it's just a completely different struggle. I don't know if I'd want to have some of the struggles that they have, because my childhood was not horrible at all, but trying to define who I am and trying to find myself later in years has always been kind of my struggle. And so I look at my own children as an example sometimes of watching what they want. And my husband, you know, we've had discussions where he's like, ah, you know, is so-and-so going to go to school? What are they going to do? Yeah. You know, just going on. And I'm like, but at some point, I think it's more important for them to love themselves, know who they are, and figure that out first, and then decide, or you have a lot of kids or a lot of people, even adults that are going to school post-secondary and then not even using their career because they're not happy with it.
Yeah, I think that, I mean, I think it's multi, you know, I don't think it's as linear as it was. Mm-hmm. I think the definition and the idea around entrepreneurship is so much more accessible.
Right.
I think that there's been a big movement around follow your passion, follow your mm-hmm. dream, whatever that yeah. looks like. Yeah. I really loved in the beginning when you talked about the word discipline. It was really interesting because my son's 19 and I think you've probably met Christine Blanchard, and she's mm-hmm. also in the book, and she's a speaker, and she's great, and she's wonderful.
Amazing.
Yeah, she has she produces two TV shows. So Ocean did his first live show, and that was pretty cool.
He's
launching his business. Yeah, so cool, right? But yeah. It was interesting because she said a standard classic sentence to him, and I was trying to be the mom that was not talking in the interview. Mm-hmm. And she said, so I think it's, what you're doing is so motivating for other people. And she kept using the word motivating. And she's like, so, how has it been? How have you kept motivated? And he's like, it's interesting. He goes, well, I don't think I've kept motivated. I think I'm disciplined.
Oh.
And I was like, that's really interesting. That's yeah. really interesting. Like being disciplined he goes, sometimes it's been really slow. It's 4 years to kick his company off, right? He goes, it's not always been fast. It's been kind of slow at times, but it was about, I stayed disciplined. And I was like, that's a really interesting, because the idea that everything is going to go like this, but I loved how you said that as well. Like through whatever it's been, whether it was one company, 12 companies,
right.
beauty industry, hair, mm-hmm. Your shop or whatever, there's been a discipline to yourself. I think mm-hmm. entrepreneurs they're disciplined to who they are as an entrepreneur. Mm-hmm. And that's really a powerful thing. I think it's a really powerful thing. Yeah. And I think that that's really what we're kind of allowing these new generations in to, like, what is it that you want to do? And sure.
Yeah.
Multiple careers, mm-hmm. multiple careers is not yeah. uncommon. They say now that the average, millennial will have six careers, not six right. jobs.
Right.
Six careers.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Well, and that thought of being able to do everything that you dream. I mean, I've heard many times in the past, even my own dad, and he's a great man. Jessica, it's not all about all your dreams coming true. Sometimes you just have to do what's hard. And I thought, now that from a great standpoint,
yeah,
it taught me to work hard, right? Absolutely. Great lessons and great values in that. One thing I've taken from that, and then as I've learned, is you can still have a dream. And if you have a business that you feel is not going anywhere, it doesn't mean necessarily sometimes you have to either shut it down either,
mm-hmm.
or you're failing at it either. I think that sometimes a business or a career can evolve because of what you're learning about yourself as you continue to dig deep within and learn what you're capable of. And I think the only way of doing that is to have our mental health in check. And that doesn't mean that it has to be perfect, because mental health is not a destination, mm-hmm. right? We heard that. It's not a destination. You're not going to get well and be there. I'm not. And when I see like TikTokers or Instagram, like different platforms, where people are excited, they're like, yeah, I'm back and I'm healthy and I'm me again. It makes me question and wonder, and not because I'm judging them, but because I've lived through it and I'm still living through it. I know for myself that if I was saying that, it would be untrue. And the reason being is because, well, I just said it, it's not a destination, it's a journey. Mm-hmm. And so I don't think that we're ever always going to just go back to our old self, because why would you want to?
Mm-hmm.
I want to take the stress and all the hardships and those trials and tribulations that we've just gone through, and I want to take that, and I want that to evolve who I am, to make me a more powerful and learn way more about myself as an individual in order to be more successful in business or career or whatever that looks like for you. It could be a marriage, a friendship, whatever, yeah. And I think all those aspects are touched when you actually have that very much individual confirmation of who you are, but then continuing to build goals and to work on yourself.
Yeah. And we see that, you know, I mean, mm-hmm. I coach, you've been working and mentoring with, you know, many people. We do, right? People come mm-hmm. and call, and I think the yeah. relationship between personal development and business growth will always be one.
Oh, yeah.
I believe that you know, you hit achievements, just always remembering to celebrate them.
Mm-hmm.
And then yes. the thing, right? The things that you've worked on in the past are going to make things in the future so much easier. It's not going to mm-hmm. like blindside you. You're gonna experience right. you've picked yourself back up. You're gonna pick yourself back up again. What is one of the most celebrated experiences that you've had as an entrepreneur? Like, do you remember one day, like when you talked about, wow, we were making thousands of dollars, or
yeah,
what's one of the things that you remember just really feeling good about your entrepreneur choice?
One thing?
Feel free to throw a couple out there if you like.
I have a couple.
Yeah.
One was, I think, when we first opened the store, and it wasn't like, yay, because we're making money. This is awful, but it was like the ongoing, you know, small town stuff.
Mm-hmm.
It was the ongoing name. We called the shop the Hoarder Shop. And everybody went in there because you could find things from like the 60s, 70s, 80s that you didn't even know still existed. Or like little doodads or whatever. If you were doing a project with your kids at school, you went there because you were like, oh yeah. And it smelled like mold and it was funky and it was dusty. But everybody went there. But so many people were like, oh, that store needs help. That store needs help. And so when I went and spoke with the woman that owned it, she was in her 70s. And she had said, you know, I heard that you were looking for a little bit of help. Is that true? I have a daughter that's looking. She's like, oh, are you finding her a job? I'm like, absolutely not. She can come find her own job. I just want to make sure that that's true. Is there truth behind that? Because I'm going to send her your way. And she was like, well, what I'd like to do is actually sell it. And I can't even tell you the enticing, exciting, exhilarating, oh, the goosebumps that ran through my body and everything, the heat wave. I felt my cheeks flushed and I was just like, this sounds so exciting. And like I just said, you got to think about that picture. I just painted dusty, moldy, it was not organized. I just, what are you thinking? No. So I took it home to my husband, told him about it that night. And he's usually really good at like helping, you know, if I'm hanging over the cliff, he's like, come on, babe, come on. No. You know, and I do the same with him. Oh no, he full-fledged, two-handed pushed me over that edge. His instant remarks were, why does that feel so right? And I just looked at him and went, what? No. And he's like, but Jess, but think about all the possibilities. And I'm like, stop, no, don't get in my head, no, because then my mind's doing this. And that was very exciting to me. And that was like probably the very first exciting thought process with it. And I know new businesses and new careers are very exciting, but that one was exhilarating. And it actually was the first time I felt, yeah, racing through my body, the flush, the what. And then when my husband had the same response, I was like, holy crap, what are we getting ourselves into? Oh my gosh. And so that in itself, even through COVID and all the things I've had to learn about myself and the things that I've gone through in the last three and a half years, June, it will actually be 4 years.
Mm-hmm.
It tells me that that was meant to happen. I was meant to have that little store. I was meant to learn and to grow as an individual, and not just that, but to really dig deep and learn some things about myself. Because even though I did have some hard times during COVID, like I said, we had some great times too. Being in a small community, our town has about 4,300 people, 4,400 people in it. Mm-hmm. And it was amazing. Everyone's like, oh, Jessica. And they'd come in and yap and hang out and visit for a little bit. And I love our small town, love our community.
Mm-hmm.
It was just exciting. And I loved going there every day. And I just felt like this is where I need to be. But then it's like, things just started opening up, and things that I had actually excused for years, but it was within myself, questions and things that I all of a sudden had to really be like, what is really going on here? and not realizing that even though I loved myself, I didn't love myself. And I didn't show myself that love and appreciation. And so I felt like, well, I knew that especially that fine line between our expectations versus our reality was mm-hmm. something I really pushed on myself a lot. And then I had to stop and I evaluated all the years of everything I've done, whether it would be in school growing up or with friends or family or business, anything. It was like my expectation to be this person, my expectation to be this way, my expectation to even the expectations I put on myself, not just other people, but on myself, of like how much money I'm going to make or what I'm going to do to build this or what my 3-year plan looked like versus now it's a 10-year plan because of COVID and all these things
mm-hmm.
started spiraling, but I didn't know how to stop it. And it was weird. And I know that sounds kind of silly, but it was really weird. And then it started bringing up a lot of the broken parts of me that I didn't realize that were in there. And so I pushed through that for about 2.5 years, 3 years. And when I tell you it was spiraling, it's probably like, if I could say 6 months was equivalent to 5 years of stress and depression. I mean, I don't know that for sure, but that's how I feel like it would have been, because mm-hmm. it was like everything I've ever done, I questioned myself. And my business started seeing that side of things. And I was like, I'm a fighter though. So I pushed through it and my business still was struggling. Now, was it because of me? I don't think so. Was it all because of COVID? I don't think so. I think there was definitely an intervention in higher power that had to help teach me some things, and not just about business, but especially about myself, in order for me to see what my reality was. And I think that's wow. really, really important that we do those things sometimes to really start evaluating, because not that I'm saying I want everyone to be depressed and stressed and hurt and going through things, not at all. But I think sometimes we push through things so much that we don't stop and take the time to actually see what we're lacking or see where we're missing out or see the damage that we're doing deeply mm-hmm. or what we're allowing people. Like, I'm a giver. I love people. I'm an empath. I love to help people, but how much I allowed people to overrun me. And that was also showing in my success of my business and my success of my family and just anything that you measure as success.
I think when I hear you share, I mean, there's lots of things that go through my mind, and I know that we're probably getting close to time. And so mm-hmm. I think that's a complete experience, right? I mean, what you were having was a complete experience. It was showing up in your business and showing up in your personal life. And I think as entrepreneurs, sometimes we, you know, I mean, at a time like that, I would hope and want someone to be able to not only be able to self-evaluate, but have those people close in your life, you know, mm-hmm. who are you drawing on in those times mm-hmm. of your business? Because the thing is, if you're owning the business, whatever's going on in your personal world, you know, yeah. If you're owning the business, you're owning the business. That can be a little bit of a detriment where you can't go take maybe a stress leave or some time off with pay or right. go to the HR department and say, yeah. you know, I need this. So sometimes things get really exasperated, and it's at those times where you need to maybe lean on your community or a business coach or your family or your infrastructure. It can be really, therapist. Yeah.
There is no shame in a therapist. Let me tell you, holy, the things that that man has helped me realize. And that mm-hmm. man has tried to retire like 4 times. He's in his late 70s. And he's like, I've tried to retire 4 times. I'm like, well, you're never allowed to. He's like, that's what everyone keeps telling me. I'm like, well, you're not allowed to. No, I need you forever. Like, just stay. But it's like the things that he's helped me learn about myself. Yeah. But most importantly, you know, the expectations that I've had on myself and the inadequacy that I felt because of those expectations not being met have completely changed. And I think it's so important that if you are feeling inadequate, and if you are feeling that, I mean, I don't know where you are at right now, whoever is listening, where you're at right now in your career or in your business, or if you're feeling like you're just not sure if you want to continue doing this, or if you want to have a completely different career change or business change, or if you have ideas. I mean, yeah, I used to be an all or nothing person, and I'm like, just go for it. Let's just do it. And when I felt good about it, I was like, yeah, and I would just jump forward. And in some aspects, I'm still that way. But I have learned so much about myself internally that I am now giving myself permission. And I think this is so important, to give yourself permission to just put your hands up and go, I need an out for a bit. Because the last 6 months of my store, I had a few people in my community that reached out, was like, why is your store not open? What the heck? And I was like, I need time.
Yeah.
And so if I took a day off or 2 days off, I put a sign on my door being like, sorry, we missed you. If you have any questions or need anything, you know where to reach me, because I needed the time. And I think that sometimes we just push ourselves and push ourselves.
Yeah. I want to stop breaking. And kind of highlight to that a little bit, because that's something as entrepreneurs. And so permission, you know, permission to take care of you while you're building your dream, while you're in your dream, even in challenging times or not challenging times. I know we have to wrap up. I know we have to wrap up, and I could talk forever. And I think that this is part one of part two. There's more to be said, but there's a lot that you have shared about success. There's lots that you shared in terms of your success, the process that it's gone to success. So look, I think there's a lot of conversation to be had. You also have an incredible, you know, you are in the inner beauty business with beauty products. So maybe if you can just tell people where to reach you, and then they can hear you on stage on the Stand Up, Speak Up, Show Up. We will be coming back for another podcast, I'm sure, and continue that conversation. So where can they reach you, hun?
So I'm on Mama J For Real on TikTok. And or Jessica Tatlow on Facebook or on Instagram. Instagram, I don't use as much, but I'm a Facebooker and a TikToker. My mom and my sister and myself were known as the red lipped ladies, or the Andrew sisters, our whole lives, because we always wore red, dark red lipstick. And when I was an older teenager, young adult, I just was like, I don't really like red. But my mom, my sister to this day, red lipstick. And so we've always been known as those women that don't go anywhere without their makeup on, which was an expectation that I killed. Right. And I almost today did this with no makeup on.
Right.
And I will go out my door now without makeup on. I wear my Costco fuzzy slippers. They're my favorite. My nugs. Because I don't even care anymore, because I've learned to love myself.
Right. I need to ask you one question. Yeah. I can hear it. So one question has got completely nothing to do with anything. This question is for you. And then we're going to wrap up the show.
You betcha.
You are on your way to a desert island, and you are taking one suitcase. Girlfriend, you can take one album with you. What album would you take?
Oh my gosh. That's a hard one. I love music.
Yeah, I know. It's a tough one for everybody. Yeah. Which one you taking?
I think Whitney Houston. I got nothing.
All right.
Whitney Houston, my girl, I guess.
Okay. Whitney Houston. Sweetie, it's been an incredible insight into your experience of entrepreneurship. And thank you for being so transparent. Look, you guys, you know what's going on. You want to go to dev@devdrummond.com. You want to go to the events page. You want to check out the Stand Up, Speak Up, and Show Up. It's going on from now till May 2024. You want to register for free. It is a worldwide invitation to men and women to come celebrate International Women's Day in all its glory, in all its gumption. So we hope to see you there. If you want to be where Jessica's sitting and you want to come on the show, you know what to do. Deb@devdrummond.com. That's it. That's all. And until next time, you guys, be well and be groovy. Thank you so much, Jessica. Yeah. Bye for now, guys.
Sounds good. Bye.